Hi, I'm Daryl Wong, one of the farm production managers here at the UCSC Farm at the Center for Agroecology and Sustainable Food Systems. Today, we're going to talk about transplanting peppers. I'm going to show you some techniques and talk about why we do what we do. So what I'd like to cover first is just a quick review of what we do to the field to get these pepper beds ready to transplant. So we would start with a cover crop in the winter. Once the rains have kind of stopped around March or April, and the soil's dried down to a workable moisture, we'll mow that cover crop. We'll go ahead and incorporate the material with our spader, so all the organic matter gets tucked into the field. We would then wait 10 to 14 days for that material to break down. Afterwards, we'd come back through and list up our beds to make the peaked mounds. After this step, there's a really important step that we always like to highlight here at the farm, which is pre-irrigating those listed mounds. What that looks like is putting out our raised aluminum pipe, our overhead sprinklers onto our listed beds. We put down about an inch to an inch and a half of water. We wait again 10 to 14 days. What that does is it establishes good moisture within the peaked mounds, and it also gives us a flush of weeds that will subsequently come back through and kill as a weed flush. It has two main purposes for the bed preparation, which is one, establish good moisture in the soil profile, and two, germinate a generation of weeds that will kill before we even plant the crops, so that we're essentially doing weeding before the plants are even in the ground. The last step, once we have the peaked mounds that have had that weed flush, is to actually come back through and shape the beds. And that's where we bring essentially a steel pan over the listed beds that just flattens out the surface so that you end up with what you see here, which is a pretty nice flat bed surface. With the soil just slightly compacted and tucked so that there's good soil contact so that the moisture can move evenly around the beds. So before we actually transplant our crops into the bed and I show you our technique, what I want to go over briefly is some of the key ideas around transplanting and what you're looking for in an ideal situation. So the first thing I want to cover is moisture in the bed. As I had said earlier, we pre-irrigate our beds so that there's plenty of moisture in the profile. And what that will look like is if I dig my trowel into this bed and pull it up slowly, you can see that there's dry soil on the surface where some of it is dried down, but deeper into the bed, there's really nice moisture that these transplants are going to get planted right into. So ideal moisture is one of our key conditions for ideal transplanting. The other thing is the kind of environmental conditions. So right now, it's pretty sunny, but it's still early in the morning. Ideally, I would call in an overcast day, but I don't quite have that power yet. So we'll deal with it as we can. At least it's in the morning, so the sun isn't all the way at the peak. Ideally, you want to be transplanting in the morning or in the late afternoon, but definitely not at midday. The other thing is that there's no wind right now, which is nice. Again, wind will increase evaporation and stress on the transplants as they get in the ground. So no wind, again, early in the morning or late in the afternoon, and ideally some sun cover, but of course you have to deal with what you have. So those are environmental conditions. There's also the soil moisture conditions. And then let's look actually at the transplants themselves. So here, we're actually going to be transplanting from 2-inch pots today. Sometimes growers will prick out their peppers into 2-inch pots, sometimes into the speedling trays, which you may have seen earlier in the videos. But I'll demonstrate with the 2-inch pots today. So what we're looking at here is a nice, strong transplant. When we actually look at the transplant itself coming out of the pot, this is really ideally what we want to see. And what that is that you can see these kind of nice white roots at the edges of the pot. So this transplant has been growing out, but it's not quite root bound in the pot itself. So this is the perfect stage at which to put the transplant in the ground so that we can have minimum transplant shock and these roots can keep extending out from the plug itself. So now I'd like to go over the actual technique of transplanting. So here again are our transplants in the 2-inch pots. So what I'll do is pull these transplants out and I'm gonna lay out just two or three to demonstrate. So again, you see I'm being relatively gentle with these transplants because again, there's a lot of loose soil around the roots. I don't want them to be too disturbed. If you had a transplant that had a little bit more of root binding around the pot edges, which again, while not ideal, is definitely okay. You could drop these transplants a little bit more aggressively. I'm also gonna double check my spacing. I want about 12 inches in between plants. I know that this trowel is about 10 inches, so I'm just adding kind of two on. And now comes the actual technique, which when you're planting out a large field, this can actually save you quite a bit of time. So I'm gonna show the technique, again, that we use here at the UCSC farm. Of course, in whatever fields or farms you might be in, there could be different techniques. This is one that we really like to use. So we focus on a couple motions here for the transplant, and we tend to like to use these sharp hori-hori type trowels because they dig into the soil very, very easily, creates less strain on your wrist and on your elbow if you're transplanting a long 300-foot row. So again, so what that looks like is that I plunge the hori-hori into the ground, and you'll see that I'm putting it at an angle slightly in front of where I actually want my plant to be. I then position my plant behind the trowel so that as I pull back, the hole that's created is filled in by the plant. It's directly in line where I want it. I'm holding my hand here to keep the position of the transplant while I pull the trowel out of the ground. And then with a couple motions, I fill the soil back and give a nice push with the hand so that again, those roots from the transplant itself have now contacted that moist soil in the down in the beds. So we're gonna have a really nice healthy transplant. So again, I'll do it one more time on a slightly smaller plant. If this is where I want my plant, I'm putting my hori-hori in at an angle in front, plunging it into the ground. I position my plant. As I pull back, I sneak the plant in, and then with a little bit of soil and a nice tuck. The last time, again, holding the plant, put the trowel in. As I pull back, the plant tucks into place, cover with soil, and I push in. So hi again, I'm Daryl Wong, the Farm Site and Research Lands Manager here at CASFIS. And we're back in the peppers now. It's now harvest time. We planted these peppers just as a refresher around June 1st. It's now about August or October 1st. So they've been in the ground about 90 days. And you can see we've been harvesting off of some of these peppers and this particular variety we're about to harvest. So again, just a refresher on what our steps were in terms of getting to this point in the peppers. We did our normal bed preparation. We pre-irrigated that ground to get a weed flush before planting. We went ahead and planted that ground, watered in these peppers overhead for 10 days, did a single cultivation pass with the tractor, switched everything from overhead onto drip. At 10 days, and ever since then, these have been on drip irrigation on a regular schedule. And then we probably came through with 2 to 3 hand weedings, and that gets us to where we are today with a full block of peppers that's all ready to harvest. So now that we're ready to harvest, we're gonna look a little bit more closely at the plant itself and the exact harvest technique. So this variety here is Cyclone. It's actually a hot pepper variety, but you would harvest these hot peppers the same way you would harvest many sweet peppers. So what you wanna look at when you're looking at a pepper is having an understanding that as the pepper has grown up over time, it's set fruit in successive waves. So the first wave will start lower down on the plant, and that's where you'll have your ripest fruit. The second wave will be slightly higher, and the third wave will be all the way at the top, where you can see there's still some immature fruit. So what we're really looking for at harvest stage, again, depending on your variety, but for Cyclone in particular, we're looking for a full red fruit that doesn't have any green on it. So you can see this is kind of green, slowly going to red. This here is a deep red, and you can even tell the skin here is a little leathery. This was probably ideally harvested maybe 2 weeks ago. And this here is kind of at our perfect harvest stage where it's a full red. You can see the skin is nice and plump and full. And this is really what we're looking for. These peppers are actually all gonna be going into a value-added process for us. Most will be smoked. So this type of leathery appearance on the pepper is really not a big deal for our harvest. So when we actually get into the harvest itself, if you'll notice, all of these peppers are set right at the forking of the branches of this pepper plant. And that's where the plant sends up its flowers and hence where its fruit comes from. So when we actually look for the fruit that we want to harvest, you can see the pepper comes directly from that little joint. And I'm going to try to grab as close to that joint as possible and pull it backwards against the angle that the stem is coming off. So if I pull it backwards against that angle, the pepper should snap off really nicely in my hand. In doing so, I'm not stressing this branch at all, and I'm not breaking that branch down. Especially if you have successive waves of peppers on that branch, you don't wanna knock this branch off where the harvest is happening. So let me show you that a second time. Again, I'm identifying my pepper, nice full plump skin, fully red fruit, identifying the joint where the stem comes out, and I'm gonna pull back against the angle of the stem, and it should snap right off. So to see that a little bit faster, you can see that there shouldn't be a lot of time or energy wasted in picking this fruit. And then our actual standard procedure for this is to use a 5-gallon bucket that we have side by side. So these peppers will just get put right into the bucket. And that's our harvest. So now to take a look at the harvest on a different variety. This is a variety called Tiburon. Tiburon is an ancho type pepper, so the type of pepper that you would use for a chili relleno or something like that. And this pepper, very similar to the Cyclone, it's just bigger, and all we're looking for in this is kind of a full, we're really looking for the size of the pepper, for a deep green. And again, you can see that we've harvested these peppers in waves already, so we're now on to a second or third wave of peppers higher up on the plant. And again, I'm gonna look for that same angle of stem coming from the branching. I'm gonna pull this away from that angle so you see it snaps off really nicely. And then I'll just put it into my 5-gallon bucket. Again, same thing here, looking for nice sizing, a nice deep green. And again, I'll just take that stem, bend it backwards, and it should snap right off. And we find that just using our hands, snapping the peppers off, leaving a nice long stem is a lot faster for us than actually coming through and using Felcos or some type of clipper to actually clip the peppers off the plant. So after harvesting the crop, one of the nice things about peppers is that the post-harvest handling is very, very minimal. If we do a good job of picking the peppers and having them land directly into clean buckets, then there's no additional cleaning that's necessary, no additional washing that's necessary. And actually, we really like to keep water off the peppers so that they'll stay fresher longer. From here, they get weighed out into crates or into buckets, then they can hit the cooler right away. And we'll go ahead and keep those. Depending on the variety, they can stay in the cooler for, you know, a week, maybe 10 days, and we have plenty of time to sell that product. So finishing this pepper crop, we finished it much the way we would finish all of our crops here on the farm. We'll go ahead and mow this crop out. So mow it with about 6 inches of stubble. We'll lift the drip tape, then we'll disc the entire field just one time, and then we'll be ready for cover cropping. And that'll take us full cycle. The cover crop will be in the ground through the winter, and it'll be ready to incorporate for next spring's crop.